a parking meter when I caught a glimpse of Rita printing out a ticket in her little machine. Told her I had parking privileges and ticketing me was a sacrilege. She cited me for parking in a bus stop anyway. Naughty Rita, meet a maid. May I inquire of the chief of police, when will he can your ass for me? Rita is finita. I tried to take her out, but couldn't finish her. The chief laughed, said she was the winner. Told him I'd try to get her fired again. Got the ticket and I paid it. Made a huge stink and I finally made it. She's gone and there's only a meter, a maid or two left. Oh, naughty Rita, meter maid. Where would you be without harassing me? You gave me a fine and I compromised you. Meter maid. Da 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 da. That's what happens to naughty civil servants that cross me. Ooh, ah!
The Sirens, Angel's Whispers, Hey Tomorrow, Is That You? Am I having a vision? No longer a prisoner of the city's missing persons. Oh, silence the sirens, I am not ready to die, and they always flash by too soon at red on red on my mind's journey too.
Very good. Thank you. Here we go. Thank you, Mr. Terrio. Now the poem, Silence the Sirens. Ready? Here we go. Silence the sirens, because love can heal. Silence the sirens because they broke the wonder wheels. Oh, be quiet, my dear one, the rushing red is much too green. Oh, be quiet, my near one, the loud static night is brighter than it should be. Well, Midas had the gold touch, but tonight he lost it quick. You see, the fire starters never looked up, and the whole lesson plan became unhinged. Oh, silence the sirens, don't forget to accept the rain that doesn't come. Oh, silence the dawn sirens, it's a brand new day, but so old grows the dying dust. And did you know the victim was he, or she, a friend to trust? And now sound is so haunting, no impulse is quite as, oh no, not that. A childhood is for such a brave investigations, journey into our lunar smiles that try on the clothes of an enchanting mind, dancing beneath a symphonic sky. While the marshmallows taste like really growing up to be a movie star, a football hero, a rock and roll singer, a better version of the school days, last class bell. Oh, I wonder if they were ever happy. Hey, maybe the ambulance and the firemen will get there on time. Apprehend the violators. If it was arson, may they drown. May they drown in their own tears. Oh, weeping willows looking like my girlfriend when she lets her hair down. And I comb my soul for a sense of performance in relation to everything I'm so lucky to have in my life and times. But please, silence the sirens. You're making my ears turn to a towering inferno of circus clowns on unicycles emerging from the smoky flames without even a drop of blood upon their ignoring of the witnesses shouting out in unison. Sometimes, the shortest distance between two points is a better day. Oh, silence the sirens, because if the world of poets and beholders should end up in a coma, no chance to express the thanks for such unspoken sensations. Oh, in the name of all off-the-wall incidents that we can't accept or let go. Well, sirens hypnotize. Sirens ripping apart the evening tide. Thou shalt not burn unnecessarily if you can wash your hands and feet in the waters of the roaring, soaring, unforgettable cries. You silence the sirens. I hope it wasn't a gun. Come on, don't break our hearts saying goodbye. I won't even repeat how it was done. Oh man, all you cool cats better overcome. All you cool cats better overcome. All you cool cats better overcome and silence the sirens one by one. Silence the sirens. Haven't they said enough? That's it.
That was good.
Passionate.
Now,
John
Ross Terrio, as a person that's running for office, how do you plan on silencing the sirens.
There's a segue.
I will have to back off that question because I haven't given it any thought.
But you're running for state senate.
Yeah, we don't.
Aren't you? Did you sign up
for the senate?
How come there are no signs in Ward 8?
I haven't started.
There's no Donna Susie signs
up.
Either. That's true.
No, she'll get hers out in a day though. Once she puts her mind to it, they'll go out in a weekend.
Well, when do they decide to campaign? Are either of you opposed?
Yes, I'm George Lambert from Litchfield's running against me.
Oh, do you have any commentary about George Lambert? Is he the guy that the pleasure saucer went down on in Litchfield?
No. George is a good guy. I like George, and he might be. George runs well. He has a good name.
He defeated you the last time.
And he beat me last time.
How did he defeat you the last time?
The Lambert name. Lambert's a popular French Canadian name.
Yes, yeah, but he kept Little Mel as a sex pet.
No,
do you think that
no,
well, he
no,
did.
No.
Do you think that the people in Litchfield? He's kind of notorious. That's not my opinion.
He beat me in Litchfield too. George does well. It's the Lambert name is well known.
Isn't it Lambert?
That's probably the correct French pronunciation.
But Mr. Terry, what do you think you offer that he would never offer, or a perspective that we can all benefit from?
A sex
so
pet
that's
free,
not in his bill.
No. Come on, let's keep it clean. George is George and I definitely.
Can we show Ross as he squirms under our intense question?
It's a difficult question.
George is an old I would consider George as a libertarian. And I'm kind of an old school moderate Republican. So that's, I mean, definitely two different visions of how government works. So that's the Republican primary. And obviously our opponent, Donna Susie, is the Democrat.
So you have family values?
I'm married with three children.
Right.
Well, you have my vote, but unfortunately I'm not in the right ward.
Oh, what ward do you live in?
Four.
Oh, you four. Just missed it. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 in Litchfield. Oh, well.
Well, do you feel like some things should never change? Some things that are good for us? We should just keep... I know they say things change to some extent. The world's changing. Well, at least it's changing and remaining the same for some people. But as I say, but
I think it's getting worse right now. Unfortunately, things are bad. I think.
I mean, why are the gas prices so high?
Well, they've dropped almost a dollar.
Yeah, they've gone down.
Yeah. So
now they're only $4.
I can tell you why they dropped.
Or is that an illusion?
No, that's real. Back in the 1970s, after John's a student of history. We had a gas crisis because of OPEC.
Sure did. Yeah.
And the government, in its infinite wisdom, said, we better have a strategic petroleum reserve. So after we had the gas crisis, they started putting, I think it was close to 1 billion barrels of oil in a reserve. So what President Biden did a few months ago, he said, to bring down the prices, I'm going to release, I believe, 1 million gallons.
But it wasn't Biden. Months. It was in 2015. That oil could not be exported. But in 2015, that former Democratic, which I call the Democratic Party now, the Republican, the Reagan Party light, because it's hardly the Democratic Party that I signed up for back in 1977 at City Hall.
Yeah. Oh, my God. Mm-hmm.
But... it was the Democrats and under Obama that got rid of the, there was a ban. You could not export that oil.
And you shouldn't.
In late 2021, the Congressional Budget Office, which is nonpartisan and highly respected, did a report saying that the effect of taking off the export ban and just selling it to the highest bidder, which means it winds up in China or Italy or wherever, was that it raised gasoline prices in the United States, and it also hurt the U.S. shipping industry, because if a Chinese company is going to buy it, they're going to ship it on their own. But it was sense. Democrats that did that. I consider them sellouts.
Mr. Terry, don't you hear? I'm sure you probably heard that.
I'm an old Bolshevik.
You can call me Ross.
I grew up with Jimmy Carter. So
Jimmy
Carter.
We were talking about Jimmy last week.
I must be a communist.
I don't drink beer on Sunday. That's my brother Billy. Billy messed me up every time.
That's a pretty good impression.
Yeah. Mr. Carter. Are you Republican or Democrat? Yes, I am.
And Ross likes a good poem.
Yes, he does.
Did you like the poem?
He's a fun guy right there. I like Ross. He's not from Georgia, though, is he?
Thank you very much.
Are you from Georgia?
No, I'm not from Georgia.
He's from New York.
I'm just doing that. I'm from New York. Now, I was going to say, did you hear about how the Chinese bought a lot of land right near a military base in North Dakota?
I heard they've been buying land.
Acres of farmland they're buying up. How do you feel about that?
Why are we allowing that?
Probably a bad idea.
The military's a bit irked.
Yeah.
Well, I figured, of course, John, you would know.
Why do we
Saudi Arabia owns alfalfa farms in California that take the Colorado oil and the lake, I mean oil, water, which water is like the new oil.
Yeah,
it's so scarce. They get the rights by buying the farms to the water, because there's all sorts of rights to the water. Not one drop ever of that Colorado River ever gets to Mexico anymore. It's long gone. But then they ship the alfalfa in their own container ships to Saudi Arabia. And the Chinese, it's in not just in Australia, Canada, the United States, are buying up farms and everything. Then they'll send the agriculture to them. Welcome to the world of globalism.
Yeah.
This is globalism. Order. And it's a bipartisan thing, too. You know, the treaty was negotiated during Reagan, Bush 1, and then Clinton signed it. Remember the 1992 election?
NASA? Yeah. Yes.
Where Ross Perot, who I voted for.
I did too.
I remember Ross.
I voted
because my father. I got $4 billion. Admiral, was that a pass?
That was a lot. Okay, you got to calm down now.
I'm sorry. Okay, go ahead. I'll calm down. I shut up. Go ahead. I'm quiet. No, you mentioned Ross Perot. He makes me laugh. Do you remember this little Saturday Night Live skit?
I don't really follow. Oh.
Where he wanted to kick Admiral Stockdale out of the car. Because Stockdale fell asleep when he had that blunder. Yeah. Remember when Stockdale fell asleep? In a big major interview, he's like, he's nodding out and everything. So the next week on Saturday Night Live, they're going, Ross, he goes, Admiral,
yeah, but
he's got a pass, Dane. He's like trying to kick him. What do you mean, boss? What do you mean? You know?
I remember in the debate, right. so Admiral Stock, and I felt bad for him. He probably shouldn't have been picked as the running mate. Yeah. He was in a debate, and he said famously, why am I here?
Yeah, and why was he here there? We have a ridiculous way of picking. We'd be better off if we had the Queen of England in the Parliament.
I got a term for you, John. Freemasons.
No. Ross was talking.
I'm sorry.
I'm not a Freemason.
No. You can't be. You're a Catholic.
Well, my dad was Catholic. My mother was Protestant. Really, Catholics can't be Freemasons?
Really? I didn't know that either.
No, they can't.
Why not?
Because it's an evil, satanic organization.
I thought anybody could be in the Freemasons.
No, they might have not enforce it anymore. It's the old days, you know, the priest would tell you, like my mother's time, you know. You couldn't even go to certain movies. The priest would be there to take your name down.
The priest was at the movie that you couldn't go to see.
Oh, they would go. They would condemn movies like Tennessee Williams' Baby Doll.
Oh, yeah. I remember
and
that.
Other movies. The Catholic Church virtually dictated censorship of movies.
That was a good movie.
No, this is before his time.
We're about the same age,
though. Baby Doll.
I don't remember.
Who was the blonde bombshell?
By the time we went to movies, you had
that. Kind of complicated. So my dad was Catholic. I would go to Catholic Church with my father's.
You weren't baptized? You didn't go to the catechism?
No, but I would go to the Catholic Church with my family. But I also went to Baptist Church with my mother.
So that must have been...
I thought your mother was Catholic.
No, my mother's Protestant. My dad's Catholic. So I would.
That's true, though, getting both sides.
My dad never really went to church, but his family, I would go with friends and family who were Catholic. I would go to.
Uh-oh, you're dripping there, Mary.
You're dripping there.
You sure there's no alcohol in that?
Yeah. I thought it was a good view. It made me more tolerant of religion because it's very different.
That's what I should see, yes.
Very.
You don't believe that the Church of Rome is Antichrist?
No.
And that the Bishop of Rome is literally the Antichrist?
No, I don't people do. That.
What kind of Protestant are you?
Not a very good one, because I used to go to Catholic Church. But
that's hard to follow.
I was kind of, it bothered me. Who's the Republican congresswoman from Georgia? Marjorie Greene?
John knows.
She's kind of really bombastic.
We don't want to talk about politics.
Oh, we don't talk about politics.
We just want to talk about political
anyway,
poetry.
She said that the Catholic Church is controlled by the devil or something. I said, oh, that's ridiculous. It's not controlled by the devil. But
you said that.
No. Marjorie Greene, a congresswoman from Georgia, I believe. She's really bombastic. She's friends with Boebert. What's that woman's name? Lauren Boebert? Boebert.
How bombastic is she?
Well, she
can we get a whole group shot? That way none of us get individually embarrassed.
Now, This is John's show. Are you going to have him read a poem before the end?
Mary, are you a Catholic?
You want to read another poem?
Yes, I am.
I got plenty of poems.
Well, I want John to read the poem.
Am I going to hell too?
I want
it. Are you?
No, of course not.
I don't think so.
I thought Catholics believed that Protestants were going to hell.
No, I've never really sat back or studied much. I got to tell you, though, I did have someone who was a really strict Baptist tell me I was going to go to hell because I've heard this Virgin Mary.
Oh, I've heard that all my life.
Yeah, when my grandmother died, I got her Mary Medallion. Oh, Mary,
she's like two Protestants. Yeah, Italian.
My mother was a little bit annoyed that I used to wear it.
My mother was so Catholic.
But, yeah, no big deal.
My mother didn't want to be buried.
Jerry Lewis said about Dean Martin one time, he was so Catholic, even the girls were named Dominic.
I had never been exposed to a lot of Baptists until I moved here, actually.
Oh, where were you from?
We were living in Tucson, and
yes, we came here from Tucson.
Catholic.
You mean Southern Baptists? Because Southern Baptists are different than Northern Baptists.
He was definitely, I would say, be Southern Baptist, and he just blew me away when he said that. And not only that, but because I was a Catholic, not just because of the Virgin Mary, but the whole thing.
You don't believe that the King James version of the Bible is literally the Word of God? I always wondered about that. Why all these scribes that were hired in England?
The Bible is the Word of God, but
it's the King James version. But it's also translated through.
It was written in Hebrew and Greek.
But I thought you Catholics have another Bible.
Isn't the original
Catechism?
Bible was
but that's not a Bible.
Hebrew, Greek, and Aramaic. So it's kind of hard to translate things, and then the.
I
King
told
James
my,
is old English, right?
Right.
I told my friend the ufologist
it was
about
written
that.
Written by humans.
Mm. Want to hear a joke? I got a Catholic joke.
Sure.
Oh no, we don't want to get banned.
Oh wait, do I know this one?
Yes, the one Dave told.
Oh, this was good.
What do you call a priest with Alzheimer's or a who sleepwalks?
Yeah. What,
an ex-pedophile?
I don't know.
A Roman Catholic.
I got one for you. This is my go-to joke, I want to. If I'm at a
is this
going to
put George Lambert in the office?
Yes, okay. And hopefully so. This is my go-to party when I'm at a go-to joke when I'm at a cocktail party.
Kind of a joke, yeah.
So a baby seal walks into a bar and says to the bartender, "Give me a shot of whiskey," and the bartender says, "Any brand?" And the baby seal, "Anything except for Canadian Club."
That reminds me of about the octopus and the bagpipes, but that's an obscene joke.
Oh,
why?
Time out. No. Okay. Jokes. Any jokes, Mary? Have any jokes? Any more?
I am no
what
good.
Was in the what's black and white, and black and white, and black and white?
A nun falling downstairs. We've told that one when we were 8 years old.
A nun peeking out the Venetian blinds. That's another Dave joke from Cruising with Mary.
Yeah, and he's a Catholic too.
He's
that
a Catholic
funny.
Too.
But that's where we get our jokes.
Remember Norm?
Of course,
yeah,
he
was Norm,
Norm
Catholic? No, Norm was Jewish, right?
Norm wasn't Jewish. Norm was, I think, a pro. You know, from Yankee.
Oh,
well, Norm probably had his own religion in a way.
That is true.
Yeah, he was a guru out in California for a while.
Was he?
He knew a couple of the Manson girls, including Linda Kasabian.
Wow.
Linda Kasabian is from New Hampshire. Oh, you know Linda? Because my friend Jocelyn knows her pretty well.
I don't know her, but yeah, I have read about her. Yeah.
Oh, about the orgy with the bikers at the bonfire. Well, Jocelyn told the great story, because Jocelyn, she had a daughter, And, you know, they knew about her, but she was only like 7 years old at the time. Joss was wearing, so this is the mid-70s. And all of a sudden, she's there, Linda Kasabian, with this big butcher knife.
Wow. Oh,
and
yeah.
She says, "Would you like to come and see the hog we butchered?"
Right, you
and
butchered
up in the smokehouse. He says, "No, no, Mrs. Kasabian or whatever her name was at the time. I think I'll pass on that one." And she said, "Even as a child, you knew, and forevermore that was a person that you actually had killed, Sharon Tate."
Oh my God. And this is a woman that was in the Manson family,
right? Originally, Sadie Mae Gluck, who was her real name? The one that was going to be the witness, but then she went back with Charlie, so they gave Linda Kasabian immunity.
Now they went to the wrong house, though, right? They got Sharon Tate, but they wanted the house next door.
No. They knew that house.
They knew that house?
Yeah. That was Terry Melcher, who was Doris Day's son, was a producer. And Charles Manson actually
was mad at him.
The Beach Boys
actually
covered a cover of his songs. He was actually had some talent as a songwriter, and he was angry because he had been at that house.
Yeah, and he was mad at the guy for some. What was he mad at?
Wasn't he ultimately rejected?
Because he didn't get a contract.
Oh, that's what. Okay.
Yeah.
Wow.
But Manson, he'd only spent a year. All of his life, he had been in prison.
Since 12 or 13, yeah.
Yeah.
Horrible life, but if you read about his mother didn't want him, abandoned him at 8 years old. She had abandoned him to the street. So from 8 years old on, he was like living out of garbage cans, you know, eating out of garbage cans, and just a horrible, brutal life.
So getting back to why do you want to be a state senator other than reading poetry on my show?
Well, poetry is a big part of it, but performance art.
Art's important.
Yeah. But no. So my biggest concern is just that to me, things are falling apart. The economy is my primary focus, my primary concern. Mm. I've said this before in another show, but here's the first thing one of the first things I want to do is make healthcare more accessible in New Hampshire. And here's my idea. So we have a lot of people graduating from med school. In the way it works, the government funds residencies. So you got to graduate med school, you got to do your residency, and then you become a doctor. There's not enough residency for all the doctors for all the kids that graduate. So right now we're wasting people's lives because they're going to med school, they're graduating, but because there's not enough residency positions, they never become doctors. Thousands of kids every year never become doctors, not because they're not smart enough, they're not qualified, it's because the government doesn't provide enough residency.
Yeah, that started during the Clinton era, too. It was supposedly to keep a check on medical inflation. They did that with nurses, too, with the proviso that you could just import doctors and nurses from other countries.
So what a few states have done, unfortunately, I try to do this in New Hampshire. I haven't been successful yet, but if I am elected, one of the first things I had a bill filed. But anyways, allow people to become doctors without doing, or not necessarily a doctor, but become a healthcare provider without doing a residency. So like we have physician's assistants, we have nurse practitioners. Allow somebody, these kids that graduate, to work under the direction or the mentorship of a doctor.
Exactly.
And so maybe they're not, you know, it, like a physician's. I work in a hospital right now as a pharmacist.
What about general practitioners?
Yeah, they general. That's what it probably wouldn't be these people wouldn't be specialists so much as they'd be more general practitioners. But we're wasting thousands and thousands of people's lives who are smart enough, they've gone through medical school, they've passed the exam.
And they just can't get
the residency, is because it's like musical chairs. There's only so many residencies. We're wasting, you know, it's insane when we could use more doctors for better access to healthcare when we're doing this. And so let's provide these kids, young men and young women, with a way to get into healthcare, which they're obviously qualified to do.
So what happens to them when they're left out in the cold?
They try something else.
They have hundreds of thousands of dollars in debt that they can't pay off because they can't become doctors.
Wow. Ross, as a Republican, are you afraid to define the word woman? Because I noticed that Democrats don't use the word woman anymore.
They literally changed the dictionary. I was told.
Well, no, that's
your people.
Well, yeah, woman and
birthing people,
birthing person,
chest fed. I noticed that after Roe v.
Wade. Birthing, like B-E-R-T-H-I-N-G, like a pilot in a ship's pilot, birthing?
No, birthing. As in having a baby.
All right. They're birthing people. Yeah. In fact, we had to postpone it, but we're having the salute to people with uteri at karaoke. Because the one before was boys, but you know we don't want to use
the word
girls.
I thought it was
girls.
Uterus. I don't think I've ever heard it as uteri.
That word again. He had the last week.
Well, it's people with uteri. I'm not talking about an individual person with multiple uteri.
I know.
Yeah, that,
and a lot of women don't. A lot of what were once called women don't even have uteruses because you know,
right?
Hysterectomies. Gotcha.
Good point, John. Good point.
But I noticed
in your DNA, you're a woman.
Well, that's a very radical proposition.
Well, I'm sorry,
it puts you with Hitler and Putin or whatever.
No, seriously.
Time for a poem.
How can your DNA say one thing and yet everybody else could say something totally different?
Well, I just noticed that after Roe v. Wade, that Democrats were not using the word women. Neither does the ACLU. They actually changed a Ruth Bader Ginsburg quote to change it to people rather than women.
I saw that.
It kind of is like, we won't get, that's a whole
thing. We define corporations now as people.
They used to be defined as people under the common law in England, too. No, they used that's the first use of the 14th Amendment.
As we move towards the robot age, by 2035, 35% of all 40% of all jobs will be done by robots.
Well, right? It's considered a fictitious person, so you can go to court and sue it, or it can sign contracts and everything.
And 1984 is manifesting right before our eyes.
Why are you staring me out like that?
No, I was just thinking back to high school when I had to read 1984. I was trying to remember the plot line.
Well, it's kind of, it's almost more Brave New World.
Yeah.
I've never read it. I never had to.
Well, I had to for high school English.
Who was your favorite president?
Class, too.
I'm sorry.
Do you do your show alone?
Yes.
Oh, okay. You know, I noticed.
No, Mary's there.
Mary, are you used to him talking over you?
I never say anything.
No, go ahead, Mary. You're on the air. Feel free.
Now he's telling me to talk.
No, go ahead. Finish your thought.
Oh, let's have a good fight here.
Yeah.
Do you know mouth to mouth?
Express yourself.
No, Ross? I don't.
You were a Marine.
I couldn't blow the CPR doll.
You wanted
to
talk about history today.
No, I just wanted to talk about one thing that I've become very interested in, and I wanted to ask you a question about.
What is that?
You could ask Ross. He's our guest.
Does anybody know what happened? Yes. It would be Monday, right? The 25th.
Yes.
I was at CMC.
2000.
Job done.
2000.
Go ahead. I'm listening.
Does anybody know what happened on that day in 2000?
And what's the day?
She already told me.
Well, what's the day?
It's the 25th.
Of this month?
Yes.
In 2020?
2000.
2000.
Give us a clue.
So that was the year Clinton was still president.
That's right.
Okay, it's not political.
Well, that's no fun.
It's...
Can I give John a hint? Yes,
a disaster?
Yes.
Wings.
Wings.
Password is wings.
You mean the TV show?
Very up show. No.
I like that show.
Very, me too. I used to love that.
There was obviously some time to crash.
France.
Yes.
The one that was shot down from, with the missile?
No.
No,
that was the earlier, the TWA.
Wasn't there one that crashed in New York and Long Island? Is that
big.
One?
No, that was.
That was TWA in 2021. Flighting.
Actually, it wasn't big.
Or was it a crash off the coast of Canada? There was one off the coast?
Yes, that was Swiss Air.
Are you into aircraft?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, have you ever read the book by, what's his name? Crash? They made a movie of it, too, Cronenberg. What's his name? He's a sci-fi writer, but he's way out there. He's English.
Finally?
Crash, about the people that get off. They've gone through car crashes, so they've eroticized.
Oh, yes.
Oh, I saw that movie, yeah.
That's a really weird movie. And the book is weird, too.
James Spader's in it.
Yeah. Right, but who's that writer? J.D. What's his name?
Lang.
You're just making that up.
Is it K.D. Lang who sings?
Yeah, oh, that's who I'm thinking
of.
So, John, do you... So, I this last year...
Salinger. Well, he only wrote one book.
Did you write
Catcher in the Rye? But back to your Mary's question.
I thought we were talking about Ross Terrio.
I thought we were talking about the airline crash on July 25th, 2000.
Give Mary, us a clue, Mary. Did you see a psychiatrist for this problem?
No. It was in France.
Oh, in France.
In France.
Metal strip.
Oh, was it the last Concorde?
Yeah.
The last flight of the Concorde.
Yeah.
There was a. I think they sued an American airline. They said a piece fell off an American airline. And then the piece went into the engine or something.
Right.
Yeah. And it crashed shortly after takeoff. I was surprised. It was.
It was such a circumstance. This is what gets me enthralled about it. It was like a, you know, if you took one aspect out of it, it never would have happened. Mm. It's like the pilot decided to fix something, which delayed the plane, and then the luggage came late, and they never added it to the weight of the airplane, which had it off balance.
Oh.
And they never put the bogies, or whatever they're called, on the wheels that keep them stable.
I think that's the main thing.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, but then they scapegoated the part that fell off the Continental. Because they tried
to
get the mechanic, remember?
Yes, they sued both of them, and they lost. Because, first of all, if those bogies had been on the wheels, he never would have gone to the left. He was having problems. They had put him on a runway that was very, maybe not up to par, and it caused the wheels to kind of wobble. And so as he's going down the runway to take off, he's reached V1 and then the takeoff, and he's over on this way. And then, of course, they've got, who was the president then? He's part the president. Clinton?
Which president? Which country?
France.
Mitterrand? Was it Mitterrand back then?
No, Mitterrand was dead.
Jacques Chirac?
Jacques Chirac. Was sitting right off the runway because he wanted to watch it take off. And this guy's heading over in his direction. And he's thinking probably as he's taking off. And he's not really comprehending he has the flames coming out the back. I don't think they ever realized how on fire they were.
Okay, Mary, Crash was a novel by J.G. Ballard.
I'm going to look that up.
It's a story about car crash sexual fetishism. Its protagonist becomes sexually aroused by staging and participating in real car crashes inspired by the famous accidents of celebrities. Hmm. Now, you could have your own show here to public TV about famous airplane crashes.
Oh,
you could act them out. I'm sure that Glenn R. J. Ouellette, he could probably provide the vocals.
There's a format.
The Hindenburg is, I wouldn't recommend that.
Mary, what's your your favorite plane
that
crash?
That kind of destroyed the Hindenburg, that took out George C. Scott's movie career.
Yes, it did.
Yeah, he was never a star after that bombed.
It was not.
Do you go to movies with aircraft in them? Did you like the airplane movies?
Actually, no.
She likes the airport
movies. Come on, when Jackie Bissett gets blown up.
That was the best.
Oh, yeah.
That was the best one.
Who was the actor? He was an Oscar winner. Van Heflin blew himself up.
Wow.
Maureen Staples.
Leslie Nielsen was in those.
Maureen Staples.
He was in the airplane, right?
He was
Airplane.
They know that they know it's you. Don't do it. And then Van Heflin, his career is practically over. He looks like he's 1,000 years old, so he just pulls it. And poor Jackie Bissett. Of course, I was 10 when I saw the movie. I didn't really know.
She was beautiful.
I got one in the oven. Who knew? 10. Yeah. This is 1970. Even though they're
scandalous.
Well, didn't Patton win Best Picture in 1970?
Yes, it did.
I don't know why Airport didn't win. That was a good movie.
The first one was good.
It was
Dean
trash.
Martin. Yeah, well.
Yeah, Dean Martin, and he was a brother-in-law. Burt Lancaster was his brother-in-law.
So I'm a huge fan of The Twilight Zone. So about
a
year ago, I got all the DVDs.
Is this what you mean? Like you're wound up in the Twilight Zone?
In a collection? No. This is all. It's all going to tie in together. You're going to see how my mind
comes full circle.
Yes, it's all the circle of life. So I love The Twilight Zone. So I bought all the episodes last year. It took me months and months to see all of them. So I've seen all the episodes of Twilight Zone.
Yeah.
And this reminds me. You talking about the airline crash reminds me of one of the great.
With Captain Kirk.
Oh, with the creature on the plane?
No, not that one. Terror at 30,000 feet. Not that one. No, there was another one. There was a.
Where the plane lands, there's nobody on it, and.
Not that one.
You know which one I'm talking about. Though,
yes,
right?
That was one of them, too.
That was weird.
No, so the one that I'm talking about is this woman is having a dream. She's in a mental hospital. Very beautiful actress. She was in a few episodes.
She goes down in the morgue.
In her dream, every night, she's in a mental hospital.
Yes.
I don't know what she is. She's very attractive. I think she was a Jewish actress. She was very pretty. She was in a few Twilight Zone episodes. Very beautiful woman. Very exotic looking. So every night, she has a nightmare in the mental hospital. She takes the elevator down, and... and I take it back. The beautiful woman was the woman. So she goes into the morgue and she goes, room for one more, room for one. And it was like room 42 or 242. So she has, until finally, after a while, they release her from the mental hospital and say, oh, you're fine. Go home now. So she's flying home, and the woman in her nightmare is the stewardess, and she's just about to get on the plane, and she goes, room for one more. She starts laughing. So this lady freaks out. She has a full meltdown, runs back into the airport, and, you know, as her psychosis comes all back to her. And as she's watching, so the plane takes off without her, and it crashes at the end of the runway and blows up and kills everybody.
Wow.
Excellent Twilight Zone episode, though. But the, most of the episode.
That was like a premonition. Final Destination movie. I don't know if you ever saw a Final Destination.
So many good ones. Remember the one with Burgess Meredith? His glasses
He was
break.
In a bunch of them, yeah. Oh, but yeah, time enough.
He was a reader. Time enough at last.
Yeah. We need to focus now. Okay. Do you think that as a Republican that that justifies your anti-regulatory stance?
The Twilight Zone episodes, yes. They fit in
if
nicely.
If there had been better FAA regulations, maybe that wouldn't have happened.
Just as an aside, as a divergent aside, I am a pilot. I am a licensed pilot.
Oh, wow.
But here's the thing.
Are you going to drop things over the city, like vote for Ross?
Here's the strange. I like to force myself to do things that I might not like to do just to have power over those things. I don't like heights.
Flying is definitely yes.
And so I force myself. I got my pilot's license. I actually enjoy flying. But ever since 9/11, I don't like flying commercial because I'm not in control. So what I like about I have my pilot's license is I like the fact when I fly, I'm in control. So I know, so I know who's getting on the plane and the luggage, and I'm in control. So I don't feel bad. But when I'm commercial, I have a lot of anxiety now since 9/11 because I'm completely not in control.
I don't have any anxiety about flying.
Really?
Well, see, that's the funny thing. I have all this obsession. No, I don't.
So you know.
Oh my God! I'm terrified.
Oh, yes, that.
My sister.
Yeah, you love planes.
My sister. It's a weird dichotomy, isn't it? Used to have to give me drugs to get on a plane.
Well, you talk like that's something bad.
Which is really dumb, because if you're in a plane crash, you don't want to be stoned.
You mean she gave you a Valium?
I'll tell you.
Yeah, something like that. You know,
thing.
You know.
I don't typically remember my dreams, but I do have the two nightmares that recur all the time.
Losing to George Lambert?
That's okay. I like George. If I lose to George, that's fine. But I'll tell you what my two... I'm back in school, and I'm one of those people that's like type A. I always prepare for everything, and it's an exam day, and I'm like...
What happens?
I never studied for the exam, and I'm like, oh my God.
That's not you.
Yeah, and then the other one is I'm on a commercial plane, and there's a problem, and we're crashing. And I have that dream nightmare again and again. I'm on a plane, I'm flying commercial, and I know it's going to crash because something's happened, and it's nothing I can do about it.
Have you ever reached the crash stage, or do you?
No. It's just I know it's happened. Yeah. No, it never crashes. Okay, it just.
Have you ever gone into therapy to find out the sexual genesis of this
no.
dysfunction?
I think it's just.
Are you ever in the cockpit during the?
No, I'm always back in coach because I can't afford
control,
first class.
You know,
can't afford
not
first
in the
class.
Lavatory?
No, I'm always in coach.
No, high club.
It's a problem with the plane.
You're
it's going to crash.
What airline is it? You see?
It's about you've been cast.
What airline it is? I take that back. One time, I knew I was on Spirit Airlines.
You've been castrated.
Did you have a bad,
by the Holy
bad
Spirit.
Experience on Spirit Airlines?
I've never flown on Spirit, but one time in my nightmare, I was on Spirit, and people said, "Don't fly on Spirit. It's a bad airline." Is it like a budget airline or something?
Yes, it is.
Well, it's hardly like domestic Aeroflot where they drive into
the worst experience I ever had,
mountain.
And it was a small plane. I have a fear of small planes, too.
Oh, I like small planes, though. I don't like
big planes. Understand what you're
saying, sexual innuendo. You better watch out for him.
Mm. Because, like, when you're in a large aircraft, you're just sitting there, you don't know anybody. And but anyway, I was on Bar Harbor Airlines.
Isn't that a TV show?
I think they're still around.
Ross, you have the best innuendo.
They might have changed to Down East. I don't know. But I got on that plane, I had to fly from Presque Isle to Portland. And it was a curtain. And the captain got up. There was one pilot, which I didn't understand. I always thought you had to have two. He got up to go use the bathroom, and I'm like going...
So did you go and help fly the plane?
No. I just sat there and I was like terrified and I was sick.
Why don't you just drive?
It was being paid for by the military.
Well, there you, was it a military plane?
No, no.
Christ, I've been ready to jump off.
And when I got to Portland, I went up. I think I was catching a Delta or something like that. And I walked up, and the woman's like, let me guess, you just got off Barber Airlines. This is,
everybody yeah, likes
how
that
did you know that? She goes, you're green.
They had a reputation, I guess. I
my wife's worst experience, flying, so my wife's from South America. She was flying. This is when we first got married. We didn't have a lot of money. So she wanted to go home to see her family. And it was Airlines Bolivianos or Airlines Argentina. I think it was Airlines Bolivianos.
Where did she live in?
Brazil. And so we were living in Boston at the time, and she was flying back to Brazil. But cheap, this is like the budget South American airline.
I think a lot of them are.
And it took her almost 24 hours. So if it's straight, it's about a nine-hour flight. But it took almost 24 hours. She said, here's the problem. It stopped like in every country. It stopped in like El Salvador, Honduras. So it would stop in every, that's why it was so cheap. So it was like a, she said it was like a bus.
Like riding a bus.
Stopped in Venezuela, Colombia, and she said it was horrible. She'd never do that again.
Oh, wow.
But it took her 24 hours to get home because of all the stops on the
And
airline.
You know what's really sad about that?
That's probably the only one that did.
That's how they determine the worthiness of the plane. It's how many takeoffs and landings they've had.
Oh, cycle, yeah.
Can you imagine? Yeah. How much they use up just on going
stress.
There and coming back? Mm. Oh, that's horrible!
I was in China many, many years ago, back in the 90s.
Wow.
And at the time, the Chinese airlines had the worst safety record. And we were flying within
worse
China.
Than Aeroflot,
worse than Italy.
It was the worst at the time.
Oh.
And
Aeroflot's it's
just strange circumstance. There was a retired Boeing engineer and his wife were on the plane with me.
Ooh.
And it was a 707. And he's like, I didn't even think these things were flying anymore.
I didn't.
It was a 707. I mean, because 707s came out in like the 50s.
Yes,
they did.
And
Somebody
China was still flying. And it was all the placards were in Russian. were in the Cyrillic. And so obviously Russia owned the plane.
Russia owned
it. And sold it to China.
They had their own plane.
It was too old for the Russians, so they sold it to the Chinese. And he's like, I can't believe
it. They probably picked it up from Vietnam.
And they screwed it up. They screwed up the loading of the luggage.
Oh, no.
And they put all the luggage in the back of the airplane.
So it's sagging.
So we were all spread out. So then they had an announcement. They said, everybody.
Move to the front.
They did. That's exactly what they did. They said, the plane is out of balance. They put all the luggage in the back of the cargo thing. So everybody needs to get this squished together and sit in the front. No spaces, just every, you know, because we're all spread out. The flight was only half full. So they made every, just squished us all far forward as far as we could to balance the plane.
Did you get first class or was there even first class?
It was all, it was coached throughout the whole plane. There was no first class.
And, what an experience.
Oh my God, it was.
What were you doing in China?
I just like to travel. I've been everywhere. Why
would you go to China, though?
I think to visit would be good as long as you can get out again.
Visit there?
I don't know.
We might find out something.
1.2 billion people.
Do you have friends in
there? More than that,
no. Actually, China is going to be overtaken by India pretty soon in population.
I think it just has.
Yeah.
I wanted to see the...
Great Wall?
The Southern... what is it called?
Hong Kong? The soldiers, the Terracotta Army?
No, it's...
Hong Kong.
It's a plane story?
No. It's a certain part of China.
What's there that makes it nice?
Panda.
They
ones?
Sell everything. Everything is
Hong Kong.
No, it's not Hong Kong.
Guangzhou.
It's something Delta.
The Mekong River Delta. That's in Vietnam.
Oh no, that's not it. I don't know. It's just
why don't you have a sip of your beverage and think about it while we go on, move on to another subject. So what do you talk about with your analyst?
Don't talk about anything. I don't have one.
You don't?
Oh. No, we don't.
Is it Republicans are against therapy?
Yeah, I talk to my wife and she says, stop bothering me.
Yeah.
And then I said, get over it.
There's
and then I go,
there.
Okay.
There's a joke there, Ross.
Yeah,
remember?
But we can't use the punchline, though.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So you admit that you're browbeaten by your wife.
Henpecked, I think, is a better apt description.
Well, there is a better word. It begins with, the P word, but we can't use that.
No, henpecked.
And you still have a happy, loving relationship.
Yeah.
That's what he says. but we've yet to see the analysis.
Well,
not
sure you talk about it. Well, here's the thing. She doesn't speak, I don't speak much Portuguese. She doesn't speak much English, so we get along well.
After all these years?
Portuguese?
Brazilians speak Portuguese, yeah.
Oh, that's right.
That's why it's Latinx because yes. Hispanics.
They don't call them
Brazilians. Got pissed off. I know real people. I know the real people don't.
I totally forgot.
This is liberals. Well,
here's the weird thing about that. I was just talking about that the other day. I don't think there's any word in the Portuguese or Spanish language that ends in an X. Not one. They're no. Most all of them are O's and A's. Although
vowels.
Sometimes,
yeah, vowels.
Yeah, they don't L's and N's sometimes, but O and A is most common. But I don't.
Well,
think
they don't use they don't use Latino
Portuguese
either.
Or Spanish that ends in an X.
Because I studied Spanish in college. And
they're almost the same language.
Yeah, they
it's
are.
More just dialect. So basically, as you think about it, the Romans took over. They all learned Latin.
Yep.
And then as time went on, they evolved, and people on the coast spoke Portuguese, and people on this side spoke Spanish.
Right. What about the really Catalonians?
What about the Catalonians?
They have their own dialect.
Yeah, of yeah.
Yeah.
Oh. The although
it's
I
a bit of history.
English. Sorry, languages is a.
So you support a English?
The Basques
English
speak one of the oldest European dialects that is not a Latin or Romance language. As is Hungarian is also a non-European.
Right, and the Basques isn't even contained in one country.
You know what's weird about the Basques is it's like a Neolithic language, like a caveman language that never was influenced by other languages. It's because
they're up in the Pyrenees. Yeah.
They're up in the mountains, and they were able to not be influenced by outside influences.
So it's pure.
And so it's an ancient language that's very distinct. And then you have Hungarian, which is obviously an Asian language, which came with
Huns. An alphabet, Basque alphabet.
I believe they use a Roman alphabet.
A Roman alphabet.
I could be wrong, but I believe they use a Roman alphabet.
Hmm. We're giving you material for more poems.
Oh. Would you like to hear a poem?
No.
Only if John reads it.
Do you have a short poem?
I do. So you didn't like my reading.
You have any short jokes?
This doesn't look very short.
No, it's one page.
Do you think Ross can read it?
I don't know.
Oh, John, no. I want you to read it.
The procreating are primitive. Can you read that?
I'm sorry, I can't.
So no poem, yes or no?
You can read the one about the Peruvians are creative.
It's quick. It's 5 minutes.
Oh, that's the short one, right?
Let's see. What do you want to hear? What do you want to hear about? How short any poem? Do you want to hear the leaves turning one or no?
Well, no, because it's not October.
Okay, all right.
Ross, what do you say?
I want you to read a poem.
I can't read his
he never
stuff.
Well.
Sounds like me. Never feels well.
Okay, I don't want to read then. Read it.
What's his poem? You don't want to hear
and
the
rhyme.
Poem?
It's about poverty.
Let him. Yeah. Sounds good. Okay. Sounds interesting.
Spark and rhyme.
Can you do performance art while you're doing the poem?
Would you like me to? Why don't we just put you in the middle?
You can move. You can do the movements while I read.
Here.
I can't, but go ahead. I want to hear this. I like the title.
Move towards the middle, and you can wave your arms all you want.
All right.
I'll just sit here and stare at you.
This is, no, you don't have to leave, John. Okay, ready? This is about someone observing basically not middle class, not rich, but really extreme poverty, but trying to analyze without really opening the book.
Before you start, I have a question for you.
Okay.
Would you classify your poetry more like Walt Whitman or Ginsberg?
Probably, maybe, yeah.
All right, okay.
I've read all so many different poets. My favorite writer is actually Bob Dylan, the rock and roll lyrical poetry.
I like Bob Dylan.
Yeah.
Although I really...
He's my biggest influence, really.
I liked him when he was with a beautiful woman... Joan Baez.
Oh, yeah.
They were a good couple.
In the 60s.
Yeah.
That was his most fecund period. I think 62 to 66. But John thinks Blood on the Tracks was his best album. Anyway, here we go. All ready?
Right, go ahead.
Okay. They're laughing too loud. Every day the sky is dancing. I can't find a rich man. I can't find a rich man anywhere. I can't see how they act so.
This neighborhood is rooting for the underdog, and the myth on the white horse is slipping its expensive pills to the slip in an often cradle of wishes. Sticking to his story of lost love and all this nickel and dimes. Oh, come on, people, living in the moment, though Mama could be watching, with a loud shout, till Papa gets home, till Papa gets home, hopefully just in time. Oh, sparks and rhyme, hearts and sad tales. Yeah, can you parallel park inside the full moons, much too hung up on the stars to drive? Your sparks and rhyme, bitter ends and you just can't quit. How many false alarms that lead to the romance of why we live and die? Trying, trying, trying to paint the mundane needle and spoon pain. Places we see till they dance like spring fever. Ask questions of the great on high. Well, there's just not enough time to use all that's there. But if I carry back from the up and coming the true blue emotions, I can't hold back, I can't hold back. We'll be well versed, maybe totally immersed in the sense of worth. Everybody needs to keep up with the sudden curveballs thrown by this seesaw of words, this lack of peace still creeping. Can you at least look alive? A little brother got gunned down. It's the excess of poverty. Big sister wants to become a nun. Right now she's got a crybaby lover on her hands. And this part of the city is all caught up in the troubles of the rich and powerful. But who really cares? Well, I do. And it's not the party music. It's the far gone, mindless rituals. Doing it, living it up. Till the police come a-questioning. The price of love. The price of love. Oh man, spark and rhyme, you must wake up. Spark and rhyme, isn't the distance between eating or medicine a capital crime? Yeah, I see you there. Watching it on TV or just checking out the warning signs. Oh, spark and rhyme, we better get going or else leave all this gold to the bandits. Yeah, what's the sense in borrowing what we won't own? What's the sense in borrowing what we won't own? Hey, spark and rhyme, what language does Mother Nature speak? In the depths of Dickensian lullabies, Dickensian lullabies. Hey, spark and rhyme, take off that mask. That little baby needs formula, that little baby needs formula. And a life, it may cost a life. It may cost a life. Spark and rhyme, spark and rhyme.
That's it.
That's a sad life.
No, didn't like that one.
There's a isn't there an open mic night where you can do poetry slam around here? You go there?
He's done it a couple times. They always make him be the judge.
Yeah, but we're gonna start though. We're gonna start one at the Art Center above the Palace Theater pretty soon.
I think there's already one going on one week night. I believe right here on Elm Street there's a poetry slam.
Really? Well, I do the stuff on my own show, and. We're on Mary's show, of course. Thank you.
Oh, yeah.
Cruising with Mary.
Cruising with Mary, cruising, yes.
Now, are you a Republican?
Yes, he is.
Yes and no.
And here's why I say
mostly.
That.
Mostly.
Because you brought up the baby formula shortage.
Well, I'm very pro-life.
Yeah, I thought that too.
I thought that was a slam against President
Biden. I don't know.
Biden.
No. Well, yeah, probably
sort of.
Was.
He's not doing it.
What do you have to do with
that? He's horrible at everything. Some people are good at everything, and some people are bad at it. He's just not very good.
No.
Here's the thing. I'm a Republican, but I will give credit. So, for instance, Bill Clinton
Trump.
I might disagree with, but the economy was pretty damn good under Bill Clinton. I remember the 90s. The 90s were a good time in America.
Didn't he balance the budget, supposedly?
Yes, he did.
No, they didn't really balance
the
budget.
But they were the deficit was almost nothing.
Well, that's president. Because of the economic alleged demand.
But I'll give credit to Democrats when they do good work. But President Biden is not a good president.
He can't even talk.
I don't think he was a good governor.
When was he ever a governor?
No, senator. He was a
senator.
Of
Delaware, right?
Delaware.
Yeah. Delaware.
I'm sorry. I mean, I always remember my brother.
You're thinking of Jimmy Carter.
I'm thinking of Jimmy Carter. Yeah. I always remember my brother making fun of him. My brother was in the military.
Of Jimmy Carter?
John. No, of Joe Biden.
Why would he make fun of Joe Biden?
I don't know.
He was kind of a nondescript guy for most of his life.
No, he wasn't. He was one of the most powerful people in the Senate.
He was a nice guy.
So this is what you're running on, not your own stuff. You're going to run against Biden.
But is he really running the show? That'd be my question.
What does Biden have to do with New Hampshire?
Everybody was running against Trump. So.
Well, we don't want people who are going to rubber stamp federal Biden policies and bring them to our state.
Oh, we don't, huh?
No.
And so that they're going to give all this dental care to people. Where do you think that money comes from? Do you think the state of New Hampshire is putting that up, or is that federal money?
So, okay, I'm glad you brought that up.
Oh, you are?
Yes, because that's federal money. This is in my wheelhouse.
Those are federal money.
I want you to Google wheelhouse and see what it's a reference to, okay? All right.
Does it have something to do with BS?
The Circle of Life, in the beginning, when I talked about...
The Circle of Life?
CMS, the Center for Medicare, whatever.
Yeah.
Federal money.
Hold on. So there's Medicare, which is 100% federal. The federal government pays for Medicare.
Right.
CMS also funds doctors' residencies. But the other thing that they do is Medicaid. But what Medicaid is... So Medicare is for the elderly, typically, is a rule of thumb. Yes. What Medicaid is for the poor. That is
state.
That's federal and state. It's a fifth. It's so Medicare is 100% federal. But what Medicaid is, which is what you're talking about, it's 50-50. So the government puts up some money, and the state has to put up money.
Yes, but then the feds will put extra money in there.
But here's the thing:
New Hampshire's not going to pay for anything.
As a rule of thumb, Medicare, which is paid by the federal government, pays about when you a doctor or dentist charges something. And right. I take that back, doctor, Medicare pays about 70% of the bill. And that's why doctors like it, because they can get by on 70%. The problem with Medicaid in New Hampshire is we're nickel and diming it. It pays about 52 to 55 cents of the bill.
Nobody wants it
because all the dentists that I've talked to with Medicaid, they won't take Medicaid because it says I lose money on Medicaid patients because it's not enough. I have overhead. I have a building. I have electricity that I have to pay for. I have insurance. I have employees.
You're talking about a problem with the provision of health care, and we're the only OECD country that has for profit. Because, hospitals like CMC, the idea that it's not for profit is kind of ridiculous.
But they are.
Since is the CEO being paid? Yeah, but that's a technicality. Yeah. They're certainly we have
that being
private
said,
hospitals too. But we live in a country where there is, look at the pharmaceutical industry and how powerful it is.
Well, they make a huge profit, isn't it?
Yeah. I wouldn't trust anything. Well, whether it's a Republican or a Democrat, they're going
to
be owned by pharma.
But
you're talking about a country with the worst provision of health care forever. I have my ex-girlfriend's in the hospital now. She's going to be wiped out financially.
You're talking about the Russian girl?
Cut that part out. But she is screwed. You have to actually have to make decisions about to even be in a hospital. And it is pretty sad where she'd be better off in Russia with the health care there.
As a voter, what's the first thing you would change, Ross?
So I talked about that medical bill, but here's the thing, and this goes probably against the Republican Party, but...
You've only got like 2 minutes.
Okay.
You'll have to come back.
As a hospital pharmacist, I would like to have a public-private partnership where everybody in the country is covered by health care. So where the problem with socialized medicine, like, England or Germany or Canada, where they say, look, we're not going to allow, for the most cases, private health care coverage. I know in Canada, you can't go out of the system because they get upset about that. What I'm saying, what Obama did wrong was don't punish people for having good private health care. He had the penalty. I believe those provisions have been dropped. But allow a public-private partner. If somebody wants to have private health care, let them have it. But if you can't afford it or you want to go public, allow those people to have it. So that's what I would like to see everybody covered by health care. But don't force government...
to make that decision.
Public health care system on everybody. If they want to have the private system, let them.
And they can afford it? Yep, I agree.
Sure, but how about people that can't afford it?
Then they
then
go
they
on the public.
And they get screwed.
Well, I'll give you one thing.
And so besides the fact, France and Germany have excellent health care systems. Don't talk about social medicine, but you can come back and pitch your whole program on, we'll have a political show. Rather than this hybrid, right?
Yeah. Right.
What do you have about hybrids? You don't like Priuses?
That's right. I don't. I don't like anything.
Can I ask you what you drive for a car?
You're doing pretty
yes,
good.
Yes, I drive a Chevrolet.
Chevrolet what?
Impala.
John's back is bothering him. I think he's doing good, don't you?
I asked you to be the host.
I think the one good thing he's got the, you ain't going to like this.
You seem very
sincere. John F. Kennedy Jr.
Yeah, he's got the jaw. He's letting his hair grow out of it.
Airplane crash?
No. Let's see.
All right, we've got the sign off.
I remember when he died. I couldn't believe it.
Okay, Ross. Look at the time. Look at the time, Ross. Why don't you let's put the camera in Ross, and Ross can say he started this out, and he can say goodbye and tell us when you're coming back, and you can talk about politics.
Ross Terrio, running for state senate, District 18. Manchester Wards 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and the town of Litchfield. My experience includes being a former state rep, school board member, and an alderman. I believe I'm the best candidate for the position. My phone number is 603-820-9064. If you want to call me or text me with any questions, I'd be happy. I have a website, rosterio.com, Facebook page, Ross Terrio for State Senate, and I'd be happy to answer any questions so you can help make up your mind. Thank you, and I will be back with John to school him on many points of life.
Oh, bye, folks.
Bye.